Tremendous advances in aseptic processing technology have been made and many operations have been modernized. However, non-sterile conditions still occur with surprising frequency, and these instances overwhelmingly occur at facilities with lower technological capability. Janet Woodcock, Director CDER FDA, has testified before US Congress about the impact of old and obsolete facilities or process elements and operations with high defect rates in validation of cGMP. FDA issued guidance for sterile drug product GMPs in 2004, and EMA is in process of revising Annex 1. Today, we are fortunate to have one of the best professionals from the pharmaceutical industry explain the EMA and FDA expectations in aseptic processing. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Uday Shetty, and as always, it's a pleasure to welcome you all to this platform. We thank you for taking time out for our webinars and for your trust and faith in us. This is what keeps us going. Let me now introduce today's speaker, Mr. Vipul Doshi. Mr. Doshi has been in pharmaceutical industry for more than three decades, with diverse leadership and operational expertise across development, manufacturing, R&D, GXP quality assurance, and manufacturing operations of parenterals, solid dosage forms, biotechnology, transdermal biologics, and vaccines. He has been leading the quality and regulatory affairs function in the pharmaceutical companies of high credentials. Throughout his career, he has been providing passionate and global leadership and has guided companies to meet the global regulatory quality standards and compliance requirements. He has been a great contributor in developing and implementing quality attributes and culture of excellence based upon a set of core values and ethical practices which integrate and improve business operations and enhance the compliance within the organization. Associated with varied roles and increasing responsibilities, he is currently Chief Quality and Compliance Officer at Cadila Healthcare Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let me hand over this virtual platform to Mr. Vipul Doshi. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Uday, and good evening, everybody. I think the subject of this webinar is, as you know, is very, very vast subject. What the FDA and EMA expect for the cGMP compliance in aseptic manufacturing. So you all know the current expectation and then current observations from the various authorities, not only from the US FDA, from other than US FDA, from the EMB. The observations and expectations are growing and growing and growing. So let me take pause here, and then I will try to justify the vast subject within the stipulated time, and then we will have the question answers. So what I will try to do that, based on my experience, I will give you the insight about some of the parameter, not all of the aseptic manufacturing, because if I do, then it would require, I think, one full day webinar. So I will touch based on the burning issues, what currently FDA is looking at, and I'll try to give you some of the answers which based on my experience. I'm sorry, there is a hang.
Yes, we
I'm
can
sorry
see
for
them.
Yes. So, what is the desired state? The desired state is a maximally efficient, agile, flexible manufacturing capable of ensuring high quality and medicinal availability with less regulatory oversight. So, there is a desired state which we are looking at. What is the meaning of the flexible and agile systems? those are the characteristics by radio capability to adapt a new, different and changing requirements. So as I mentioned, that FDA is looking for the newer requirement to see that okay, how the sterility assurance levels are maintained. So before going to the, those expectation, I want to just give you the glimpse of the top US FDA 12 citation. You can see that in 21 CFR 2111.113B, and then 21 CFR 2111.113B, there are two things like procedure for the sterile drug products and validation lacking for the sterile products remain in the constant focus for the FDA. For the MHRA deficiency, as for the annexure 1, the deficiency related to the precautions to minimize contamination remain top of the list. So some of these points which we will take care and discuss during my coming slides. So these are the some of the guidances by which the regulator they operates. As you know, their guidances are not very clear and scripts. We need to interpret our own guidance and we have to prepare our own procedures. So what I try to do that based on the expectation of the different guidances, based on my learnings and my experience and then peer companies observations, I have prepared some of the case studies or the expectation, and then I have given you some of the example in that. So these are the FDA, that is guideline on sterile drug product by aseptic processing, October 2004. As I know that they are now working to harmonize with the Utralex volume for annexure 1, so there will be harmonized guidance which is coming. The PICS guidance is also the annexure 1 manufacturing of sterile medicinal product, that is 1st May 2021. The WHO, and I strongly recommended you that WHO technical report series 9612011 in annexure 6 is real good guidance, and then if we follow, then I think we can comply to the all standards. Japan also is having the guidance for industry for sterile drug product produced by aseptic processing. So as I mentioned earlier, the always remember quality by design, because sterility. Because sterility testing, environmental monitoring, and media fields can not assure product sterility. So quality by design is a key aspect to achieve the sterility level. So I will just give you the sterility assurance transformation. So you can see in 1950, there were conventional clean room operations. Then it improves in 1990 and in 2020. Now we have wraps or isolators. This is a very interesting slide, the sterility assurance transformation, where the separation concept is coming in picture, where aerodynamic to the physical separation meaning, wherein increased separation of the process from people and the surrounding environment, that is increasing level, and then low to high increasing product protection and low risk reduction. So earlier, as I mentioned, conventional clean rooms, then wraps, and now isolators. So this is a separation concept. So separation from what? Separation from the human being, which is the main source of the contamination in the aseptic operation. So cost for poor good compliance is aseptic processing is what? Like I give some example. US FDA issue 101 citation from 2018 globally due to violation of the CFR 211113, which is procedure designed to prevent microbial contamination of drug product purporting to be sterile are not established and followed. And they have issued another 72 citation from 2018 globally due to the violation of 211.42. which is aseptic processing areas are deficient regarding the system for monitoring and environmental conditions. So we'll touch base on this, what are those violations. So what happens to the cost of the poor compliance? The multiple warning letters, loss of trust, business loss, and reputation damage. So do we really require this? No, we certainly not. So what we need to do, that is what we are going to discuss here. And you must be doing that, but this is just the refreshing for you to and something new. If you want adapt, it will be helpful for you. So these are the some of the regularly expectation, learning and challenges. So the environmental monitoring trend data. So this is what I'm going to touch base, but I want to mention here that the trending of the EM data is very crucial. And then based on the trending, the repetitiveness of the microbial data deviation is more crucial in that. In such cases where you have the repetitive microbial data deviation, how you handle that is a key point. Whether you will able to do the isolation, you do the identification, whether you go to the source from where it is coming, and then you, whether you do the elimination of those microbial data deviation, and then the repetitive issues of the microbial contamination, that is a key point. So here the FDA expectation is that effective action have not been taken to address this recurrence. So the regulator expects that you have to take the effective measure, the effective CAPA. So how those effective CAPAs are being taken? First is from where this repetitive microbial data deviation is coming, from where these microbes are coming. How you handle those microbes? Whether your disinfection program is capable to eliminate those things, whether your human behavior into the aseptic practice are good enough to control this, whether your environment are good enough to control this, whether your HVAC system is good enough to control this, whether your white utility or clean utilities are able to control this. So these are the few questions you yourself has to ask. You have to see that from where the source is. Source is from the D2C, C2B or B2A, whether it is a human, whether it is an environment, whether it is utility. So these are the few things which we really need to do during the investigation and identify and then eliminate. Monitoring of the sterilized tools. This is a very peculiar expectation from the FDA, but still it is required to do that because there is a risk if you don't control this. So what they are expecting, that like scissor, which is used for the opening of the stopper bags, or the sterile rods, which is used to remove the stuck stoppers, which are sterile forceps, which is used to remove the pollen germ stoppers, or the taking out the vials. So in such cases, the FDA expect that instead of you monitor once in a week, you should monitor on the end of the shift, end of the run. Another point, their expectation is that the location is chosen is random in environmental monitoring. I will go more in detail in my next slides, but the selection of the environmental monitoring program, whether it is viable or whether it is non-viable, you cannot have the random. It is based on the scientific rationale and risk-based approach. What is a scientific rationale? That is based on your traffic, your man movement, your motel movement, your personal movements, where your air movements, whether there is a possibility of the turbulence. Those are the areas where you have to identify, and then you have to consider those to do the selection of the environmental positions. Like here, and in this particular case, the strip curtain was there into the grade A zone, and then with that, the strip curtain was never sampled or is randomly sampled. So this is a regulator, they don't like that. In the lyophilization, the partially stopper aseptically filled glass vials are manually transferred from filling equipment to the lyophilizer. So manually transfer for the half stopper vial is a concern nowadays for the regulator. And I know that all the manufacturers or the companies are not having the automatic loading and unloading systems. Fine, good enough. But in that case, what we need to do? So we need to convince the management to go for loading and automatic loading unloading system. So that is the first thing. If it is not possible, then go with the semi-automatic loading unloading where grade A to A transfer. Manually loading unloading, I don't think FDA is anymore going to be expecting that from the sterile operations for the lyophilized products. So here what they expect, that a non-viable particle counter sensors are placed in such a way that it really captured the real movement of transfers. So here it was not, and they have cited, given the citation to the company. Investigation into the failure during periodic qualification of the terminal sterilized cycles. So it was a bad investigation. They have not done a good job in to review the history of the terminal sterilization qualification parameter, and then they have redefined the parameter without any understanding and science. So wherever there is a failure of any qualification, please go back, review your previous qualification, and then understand what were the previous qualification, what were the success, and then now if it is failed, in which parameter it is failed and why it is failed, and then to meet that previous qualification parameter, which is linked to your URS and which is linked to your design, you have to achieve during your periodic qualification those desired state. Viable air monitoring of grade A cooling zone where the autoclave is unloaded and filling machine parts are stored. So generally, everybody in all the companies, once the material unloaded from the autoclave, it is stored into the grade A area till it is used into the manufacturing or the filling of the product. So this particular area is monitored once per week. So even though it is stored in the grade A area, the monitoring was not done on the daily as per the grade A environment and requirement. So the expectation is that it is to be done as per the grade A. Another point is that these are the common observations and there are common expectations. The operator passes their hands over the open bags of sterile obstruckers. This means that you are obstructing the laminar HEPA filter air flow. This is during the bag cutting and handling. So I don't know about the many companies, how the bag loading systems are there, but 99% times the bags are been loaded manually. Because automatic bag cutting and loading devices are very, very expensive. So in such cases, what we need to really do, that we need to do think out of the box and see that how the bag is cut and load into the stoppering bowl without any obstructing the laminar flows. There are 10 transfer hatches used to move material movement, like as I mentioned, quality by design. So quality by design is not applicable to the product. Quality by design is applicable to everywhere. So in aseptic manufacturing plant, the design is also based on the quality. So many times what happens that the hatches, which are the transfer hatch or transfer doors, which are designed, are from grade B to directly grade either D area or C area. So in such cases, the interlockings are there. There may be HEPA filters in between. But what happened that if in such cases, there are no monitoring of the hatches. So because it is going from the higher clean zone to the lower clean zone, and there are, I'm sorry, there are interlocks which are there, but the regulator expectation that you have to really monitor those hatches which are barrier between the grade C or grade D area to the grade B areas. The personnel working in with their body fully inside grade A stopper addition. So as I mentioned, stopper addition is a critical part of the entire operation, where operator has to go inside the laminar flow and they have to cut the bags, they have to unload the stoppers into the stopper bowl. So during that time, since they are going into the grade A area, and if we monitor the operator for the ground monitoring, the grade B limits, which is not acceptable. So FDA is expecting that if the person is going into the your laminar zone, then their gowning monitoring should be as per grade area. Validation of filling line shall be done after any modification of ease of operation for the improvement. This is simple. The media field failure division did not address the root cause for the high bioburden count and the finding of the following organism. So sometimes what happens that the media field has failed, this is very obvious. I don't see and foresee that you are 100% successful in all the media fields. So media field failures are obvious. We have to raise the deviation, we have to do the investigation. In such cases, when we do the investigation, generally we go to the isolate the organisms, we species the organisms, we do the up to genus level. So that is okay. But now we have to go with the 5-Y technique, from where it is coming, why it is coming, who has handled this, how to control this. But one more thing which is very critical, that once these organisms are identified and species and nomenclature is given, we need to identify the source, that is one. Then what we need to do, we need to really see our solution disinfection is capable to eliminate these organisms. If it is not, whether we have done our disinfection validation against these organisms, whether it is our normal in the normal library or whether it is something new. If so, those are something new in not in our normal library, then we need to do the recovery studies. What is a recovery studies? That your media is capable to recover these organisms into the normal growth. Suppose your media is not capable to this growth, these organisms in the normal growth pattern, then it will give you the false negative. So that is a real concern, and then media field considered to be fail, and you have the serious problem if your media is not capable to grow these organisms. So you have to do the real recovery for these organisms from the whatever the media plates you are or media you are using. So as I mentioned, effectiveness sake of the disinfectant used for the filling line shall be part of the media field failure investigation. I already explained to you. Non-sterile compressed air may come in direct contact to the product line during circuit cooling after CIP, SIP. So this is very interesting. I've seen many failures in CIP, SIP, and I've seen the media field failure because of the CIP, SIP failure, because of that media field fail. And CIP, SIP is fail mainly because your compressed air is not properly maintained. There is a possibility about your inline filter is ruptured. There is possibility your inline filter is not properly sterilized. And then another top of that, the bioburden specification is given less than 5 CFU instead of 1 CFU because your compressed air getting sterilized using this filter. So you have to really think about what should be the bioburden for this filter, which is used for the filtration of the compressed air, which is coming in contact with the CIP, SIP, where your product is going to be stored. Media field bulk bioburden should have the specification limits. 3 media runs shall be taken if any periodic intentional media field failed. Disinfectant contact time should be established, like IP and H2O2 are used for disinfecting the interior of the filling machine. So this is a very interesting point. So do you think that you are capable to do disinfect all your contact part and difficult to reach area of your filling machine or your other aseptic equipment where the product is coming in contact? I think no. So in such cases, what to do? Are we going to use only mops or wipes, or we need to do the spraying? So my special recommendation to you is that identify the risk where difficult to reach areas are there and use the spraying techniques. And when use the spraying technique, you have to validate the disinfectant not only by the wiping or mopping, also by the spraying. And the visual inspector failed during his challenge with visual inspection challenge test. So this is interesting. I will touch base in my next slides. So common FDA findings like smoke study, as you know, The smoke study is top of the list of the FDA regulators. So what they are looking at the airflow pattern. So airflow pattern, if you want to really see the what we should have, so we should have the proper visible smoke. So dense, either highly dense smoke or the very less dense smoke is not acceptable. You have to ensure that the proper dense smoke, which is visible, is required. So the airflow pattern were not visible and could not evaluate due to insufficient smoke. So that is one of the main points which FDA is looking. Another thing which FDA is looking, that the person is doing the smoke study, and then the photographer is taking the videography behind the person who is doing the smoke study. So the in the videography, you can see the back of the person, not the smokes. So your angle of camera where you're doing the smoke study in such a way that your smoke is clearly visible. So my highly recommendation is that you use two or three different camera, and before doing the smoke study, you do the engineering smoke study. What is meaning of engineering smoke study? You place the different places, the different camera with a different angle, and see that a smoke is visible and correct, no hindrance, no obstacle, nothing. And based on that, you decide where the camera, one is a static camera, one is a moving camera, and you take the smokes. So media fill, I will touch base on that media fill. The media fill is a big subject for the any regulator. The biggest item is for them is your integrated and non-integrated, integral and non-integrated vial incubation. So if your incubation of the justification for non-integrated vial is very critical for that. And then all the simulations studies. Now my strong recommendation that is your aseptic stimulations or aseptic practices, what you have to list it down based on your last 1 year the aseptic manipulation studies, like how many times you open the doors, how many times you load the stoppers, how many times you sanitize your glasses, how many times you are open fallen the vials. So based on this, you define your interventions, aseptic interventions which you know to do during your media field. Otherwise, your commercial runs are different and your media field runs are different. In such cases, you have the serious issues and it can convert to warning letter. So these are the, some of the FDA sterile drug product inspection guidance, like compliance program 71356.002A. I recommend you should go to that. I have narrated some of the points from that. Yeah. What FDA or regulator or US FDA, because this is from the US FDA, will come and look for the doing the FDA audit. Like critical operation that should be covered during an inspection on the production systems, which include the risk of contamination of the overall manufacturing operations, should be carefully observed. So here, the risk of contamination, what you think and what I try to explain may be same, but I want to give more emphasis on not only risk into the aseptic manipulation or aseptic area, risk in the design, risk into the your HVAC, risk assessment into the wide utilities like water systems, clean streams, compressor, nitrogen, risk assessment into the personal man and material flows, risk assessment about the facilities, risk assessment into your designing and selecting your equipment, risk assessment, as I mentioned, about the separation from the operator to the product. So all these risk assessment should be part of your entire risk assessment program. Like what they are looking at, adequacy of aseptic technique, personal behavior, and practices in the clean rooms, movement of people and materials before and during the aseptic operation, robustness of the production process design, like process performance validation, impact of equipment configuration, and on ergonomics of aseptic manipulations. So this is very interesting point, ergonomics of the aseptic manipulation. So many of you must have the your filling machine in design in such a way in the area where you must have the conveyor, which is you have to swing the conveyor and go to the next side. So if that is the case, then it is not properly designed, the filling machine, and then the area, the layout is not proper for that. Nowadays FDA is not for the swing conveyors. You have to design your area. If you want to go to the other side of the machine, my strong suggestion, if you have the old machines where you have swing conveyor, stop that and create, if you have the space on the other side of the filling machine, the another change rooms to go in that area, rather than either jump or climb or go below the conveyor belt or the swing the conveyor belt. Real-time observation of the higher risk operation include but not limited to the setup of filling lines, cleaning and disinfection of the line and rooms, aseptic techniques, material flow, personal flow, as I mentioned. And nowadays the expectation is that there should be the unidirectional flow. What is unidirectional flow? It is a age old requirement, but nowadays the used equipment, use process, and use people should not contaminated the unused, like clean corridor and dirty corridor, clean entry and dirty exit. So this is how the design should be, which is a new design, which is called as a quality by design, where you avoid the cross contamination. Media fill, verify media fills represents the actual manufacturing operations. As I mentioned to you, you have done extremely good in media fill. You have done the media runs. But what happened during your commercial run, you are back to normal. Your media fill has taken, let's say, 8 hours. And then your commercial run has completed within 4 to 5 hours. So you are not representing the media. You have 4 operators and commercial, you have 7 operators. So you are not representing. So you have to see that your commercial operations, which are there, is represented in the media or in the worst condition in the media. Sterile filtration, verify filters used in production area identical to those used in validation studies, those submitted in a drug application. Determine that validation of filter sterilized has been performed for all the products. Sterilization and depurization of containers, closure and processing equipment, what they are looking at. Review the validation of the revalidation of sterilization and depurization processes. Verifies the validated parameter, loading pattern, cycle parameter. So it's another interesting point. You validate your pattern. Like in depurization tunnel, you validate with the 2 ml vial. Okay, great, excellent. And then you have the fix, you validated the X speed of the conveyor belt with the 275 or 330, whatever the, and 3 minute or 4 minute exposure time. Now you are running the 10 ml vial, or do you are running the 30 ml vial? Have you validated the 20 ml, 30 ml vials? Because the entire pattern will be different, your load size will be different, your weight will be different, your speed will be different, your heat penetration will be different. So you have to really, my strong suggestion, don't matrixing here. You do all your format size for the conveyor, depurization terminal validations. Same way in the autoclave validation, you do the porous load, non-porous load, mixed loads, then your wet loads. There are many different patterns of the loading. So you have to ensure that your commercial runs are matrix validation are within that matrix. So it's very difficult, because unless you have your program you have your software or you have some photographs in your system, operator is going to lose some mistakes by doing the different type of loading into your autoclave and you have the problem. Terminal sterilization, review validation, revalidation of periodic evaluation of terminal sterilization of cycle of represent the types and products. 100% inspection of injectable products, including cracks, visible particles, and other significant defects. What I'm trying to explain is these are the things which FDA is looking during the your inspection. Personal gowning training, aseptic techniques, environmental and personal monitorings like adequacy of the SOP, personal monitoring, efficacy of disinfectant. I already mentioned about that. Identification of organisms, I explained that, including procedures that require evaluate the positive sterility test and media fill and lal failure investigation. So I mentioned about that media fill failure is very, very critical. And 99.9% time, my experience says we are not good in media fill failure investigation. So generally, we jump to the conclusion, and then our SOP says, okay, if you have the identified root cause, you repeat the one media fill. But 99.9% time, my experience is we are not good in the investigation and the investigation of media fill failure. So we try to do everything. Please do that and go up to the probable cause. But follow with the proper CAPA based on the probable cause. But do three media fill, not do one media fill. So that is my strong suggestion here. So what is aseptic manufacturing? As for me, is a people, process, and technology. So what it covers on the people, like obviously that is a attitude, positive attitude, thinking, positive thinking, optimization, success. So all these things are there because we are discussing about the aseptic manufacturing processes. So first, we need to have the culture for that. It's not normal, right? Okay, we don't, is easy because we don't have to do the bioequivalence studies, which is difficult for the OSDs. But here it is very difficult. We need to live with the live organisms. Because many times I mentioned to my team, don't tere jaoge. We will never identify from where those bugs are coming. So though there are the contamination controls are there, the design of the building, design of the facility, design of the utilities, design of the processes, design of the material movement, design of the personal movement, design of the validation parameter, the qualification package. But most critical is the people. People is the source of the contamination. So people, their skill set is very critical. You design, currently we are not at that level that there is no people intervention. Nowadays machines are available which are robotic in the isolator, but those days will be far away and it's very, very expensive. I don't think in the generic industries we will be able to afford that. Nowadays also the isolator line with the cleaning CIP, SIP also is very expensive. It costs almost more than 75 crore rupees. So I don't know whether generic industry is going to afford the robotic. So people is a key point here, which we need to really control. And then to control the people, first the requirement is the culture. And second requirement is that their skill sets. So what are the skill set? Thorough knowledge and understanding of the respective applicable SOPs. Demonstrate an understanding of basic microbiology, because my strong suggestion, whosoever is going into the sterile area or whosoever is going in the clean area should have at least basic microbiology understanding so that they will respect and they understand what are the problems if they misbehave in the areas or the processes. Understanding of aseptic practice theory and clean rooms. Demonstrate gowning proficiency by actually completing three consecutively successful gowning procedures. Successfully complete a media transfer evaluation within a grade A hood in a laboratory environment. Successfully participate in process simulation runs. Cannot be a grade A until fully, cannot enter into the grade entry fully qualified. Frequent glow gown surveillance, if failing, must have retraining. So these are the some of the skill set which we require and we have to impart. So I am not asking about training, I am asking about the skill sets. And then what FDA has seen in the people during the inspection work in the filling operation, and operator was observed leaning over to the filling open while during the intervention. So this is obviously the operator error. How you can lean over the open valves? The skin around the operator's eyes was uncovered and exposed inside the purported class 100 sterile filling area. So operator's is a lethargy, the skin is exposed. During assembly operation, the equipment parts are removed from the mobile LF cart, exposed to grade B condition, and then transfer into the filling line, exposure to grade A area without sanitization. So person is removed from the grade A mobile trolley so that it comes obviously into a grade B environment, and then it has gone back to grade A. So A to B to A. In such cases, the SOP demands that the outer cover of those parts which has come into B area has to be sanitized. That is first thing. And then the outer cover, which is sanitized paper, has to be removed so that the inner portion of the equipment or the parts are still covered with the autoclave paper. The operator's gloves and gowns were observed to touch the filling ports, have exposed skin on their faces. Dispensing operator cleaned the food floor in front of the balances inside the hood with the sprayed wipes and did not change the gloves. Operator were seen touching their gowning. In one case, operator touched their lower leg shoes, then proceeded to touch the stopper bags. So these are the operator interventions which they have done the wrong thing and FDA cited the things. I'm sorry, I'm going a little slow here. I have another half an hour. I'll try to catch up. The personal training, as I mentioned, that is a competency. One is a skill set, one is a competency. So phase one, CGMP training, personal hygiene, good document practices, data integrity, basic microbiology, entry exit procedure. In phase two, job specific training, that departmental operational training, maintenance training, skill based on the job training, aseptic interventions, machines assembly, videography or ARVR training on media field, smoke studies, cross-functional and quality management system. In phase three, in the personal qualification, operator gowning qualification, visual inspector, analysis and microbiology visual inspection qualifications. So some of the citations, I will not go through that here, but these are the competencies required. These slides are available to everybody, so you can go through that in future. In the gowning qualification, my suggestion that you do the additional sampling from the various points from here. So this sampling will give you the reveal what are the difficult areas or what are the high risk areas, and based on this outcome you define which are the area you will routinely monitor. So these are the almost more than 14-15 positions which you take the Rodec plates and then define and determine which are the high risk areas for the gown for the routine monitoring. So what regulator expectation is that the program that established both initially and periodic basis, the capability of individuals and sterile gowns, the cleaning maintenance monitoring in those that across clean rooms, should receive regular training and gowning qualification, periodic reassess the at least annually the gowns, FDA expect that qualify people should go to and permitted access to the aseptic manufacturing areas. Gowning qualification should assess the ability to clean room operator to maintain the quality of the gown. So these are the some of the FDA expectation. Gowning qualification not required for isolator technology. That is critical if you have the isolators. In the personal qualification, the prerequisite is basic GMP training, impact of the personal hygiene and health, basic microbiological education and background, gowning training and certification, appropriate clean room behavior, proper aseptic techniques, specific clean room operation and function, as well as relevant intervention procedure training. So appropriate clean room behavior and the intervention procedure training, these are the two things which I suggest strongly to you, that you have to continuously educating them. What we used to do, that take the engineering media runs. In the engineering media runs, we show to the all the operators and we ask them where they have done the mistakes. We do the videography of the gowning, we do the videography of the assemblies, we do the videography of the disassemblies, we do the videography of the routine practices in dynamic condition, and those videography we use for the training of the people, for the especially for the behavior in the aseptic area and then intervention into the aseptic areas. Visual inspector qualification, like EU inspection rate should be, inspection rate should be appropriately controlled and qualified. Operator performing the inspection should undergo visual inspection qualification at least annually. Use of appropriate sample from the manufacturer defect library sets, and taking into consideration worst case scenario. What US says, non-size particle defect should be used for visual inspection qualifier. Non-size particles, so we have to create the defect library with the non-size particles now, which are available commercially, which use this as a preparing the qualification kit, and that can be used for the qualification of visual inspector. Probability of detection qualified detect kits should be used for visual inspection qualification. So this kit can be prepared based on the available particles or based on your own defects which you are creating, and then prepare that kits. Following critical process parameter are monitor for manual visual inspection qualification, that is light intensity, which is 2,000 to 375 lux, and the clear glass, and not less than 8,000 to 10,000 lux for amber glass. Background and contrast black and white. Inspection rate 10 seconds per container, that is 5 seconds each. Container handling and movement and magnification if it is required. I already touched base the quality culture. If you don't have the culture, if you don't have the attitude, if you don't have the agility for the training and then learning skills, you don't have the behaviors. So all these are, if you're not there, I don't think you are, we are fit to go to the aseptic manufacturing and processes. Coming to the processes, the microbial contamination control strategy in aseptic processing, and the contamination control is not a paperwork. So contamination control cannot be attained unless product requirements are set per patient risk, knowing the real risks, not perceived risk, having the right knowledge base to assess this risk, and designing the facility process and testing from a risk perspective. It is a mindset. So microbial contamination control strategy in aseptic processing, contamination sources, as I mentioned earlier also, I will reiterate, facility, which is poor design, aging facility, poor maintenance, cleaning and disinfection, which are not qualified. People, and I'm again and again coming to the people, because people is the main source. If one is a culture, second thing is a competency, third is a skill, fourth is a training, and fifth is a continuous monitoring of the people and their behavior. So like gowning rooms, attire, standard operating procedure understanding, and materials, pass-through sterilizer like autoclave, trites, ovens, depolarization tunnels. So if these are not properly designed suit for your processes, then there is a contamination sources. Decontamination chambers like ETO or BHP UV light, or material handling airlocks. I I have given you, and there is a citation, material handling logs or the pass box. If it is not properly monitored, you have the citations. Effective microbial contamination control, I have mentioned facility design. So in facility design, you have the core area, which is high risk area, low risk area, little low risk. It's like A to B, B to C, C to D. Now, if you have the isolator, great, then you don't require B area. If you have the isolator, then surrounding can be C area. That is great because isolator is isolator. As I mentioned earlier, the graph, the separation is already established in isolator from the product. But if you don't have the isolator, then you have the open reps or the closed reps, or you have active reps. Then you certainly require the B area, which is surrounding, then supported by the C area and supported by the D area. So even though I'm not here, but I will touch base for the environmental monitoring, where you have the repetitive microbial data deviation. In that case, that is happening into the B area, you really have to go to the C area and do the trending and see that whether this particular organism is traveling from C to B. So if yes, it is traveling from C to B, then you have the poor facility design, you have poor air balancing, or you have poor man material movements. So there are many instances. The once the airlock doors are open and closed, it takes some time. So your HVAC system in this design, because everybody is aware, once I open the door, air is going to be neutralized. And then once it's closed, another door is open. So interlocking is must. That is first thing. And second thing is that there has to be audio visual alarm if the pressure is going out of limit. These are the two basic things which is required in facility design when we do that to avoid the cross-contamination if it is traveling from C to B, your organs. So clean room, then personal equipment, material and waste flow should, as I mentioned, that clinic clean entry and dirty exits. So this is how the new systems are getting designed. Pass-through HS without active filter air supply should be avoided. So I already touched base with you. So what is a microbial contamination control strategy? One is facility design, then another is process design. I will give you the very classic example about the process design. Like you have the suspension product. So that is a aseptically aired suspension. It's not in situ developed. So aseptically aired suspension active material. Now, if it is not properly designed, you open the valve and then you manually add it, you have the grade A interventions, which is not suitable. And I don't think you will ever pass in your media field because you have to do the simulation of that particular addition of sterile material into your open container. So your process design in such a way that aseptic manipulation and intervention will be avoided. Then personal training and monitoring and gowning, I already mentioned and I reiterated again and again. Cleaning and disinfection, I mentioned to you, I will touch base if I have some time on this. But cleaning and disinfection, I will touch base now. The disinfectant is to be selected in such a way that it is challenged with your all the USP organisms. That is one point. But it has to be challenged with your house organism. In that house organism, you have to select also for the spore-forming bacteria. So you have the vegetative cells and you have to spore-forming bacteria. These are the two things you have to select. Your disinfectant library should have the sporicidal agents. And sporicidal agents should be used at least once in a week to ensure that you have the bacillus subtilis, which is a spore form. Now you have to really develop the spore and do the disinfection study. I have seen in many companies, they call it a disinfection validation study for the sporicidal agent. but they have never developed the spore. They have done the study on vegetative cells. So that is a clear-cut violation of your validation parameter for the sporicity license. So I just give you one classic example about where the industries are failing in that. Effective microbial contamination control strategy is process design, as I clearly mentioned, the open reps, close reps, then isolator. Then contamination control measures should be designed into such a part of the process, like cleaning, decontamination, and sterilization. As I mentioned in my earlier discussion about the tunnel. So now in tunnel, we are excellent in doing the tunnel validation. But are we doing the tunnel validation with the non-viable? Now FDA is expecting that you have to do the tunnel because you are claiming as a grade A zone. Your cooling zone is grade A. Your sterilization zone also is grade A. So you have to have the non-viable monitoring and validation and routine monitoring for the tunnels. Transfer method for primary packing material, consumable and intermediate products. As I explained to you, from autoclave, it goes to your unloading zone. That unloading zone is a grade A. Now you claim that is a grade A supply or grade A. My recommendation, you mentioned that as a grade A supply. Why? Because your sterilized articles are already wrapped. So it's not necessary to claim that is a grade A area. If you want to claim that is a grade A area, then you monitor as a grade A. If you claim that is a grade A supply, then you monitor as a grade A supply. So from autoclave to grade A, from grade A, it passes through mobile trolley. Don't use the open cart because then it will pass through the B area. So we have to ensure that material is passing through the A2, 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 E. So if it is exposed to the B area, then you have to do the sanitization of the outer portion and then remove the inner portion into grade A zones. Personal training and governing training, I have already touched on this, because the culture, the skill set, the competency, training, all these for the people and their governing practices are key factor to control your microbial contaminations. Cleaning and disinfection, I already have mentioned about some of the examples, that please make sure that during your disinfection validation cycle, use at least one sporicidal agents, because that is expectation. Because in environment you have the spore forming bacteria, and when they will convert to the spore forming, we don't know. So it is always better, and ensure that when you do the disinfection, you have to really develop the spore. Don't do that on the vegetative cells. Environmental monitoring programs, I don't have much time here, but I will give you that the selection of the viable and non-viable position for the plate exposure is critical. As I mentioned earlier, it is based on the risk. The risk is identified, and based on that, the selection of the position has to be selected. What we have done, we have prepared the grid approach. And then the risk approach. So suppose we have the big area, so we have prepared the grid of those areas, and then we have done the assessment of those grids, that grid is coming to which zone, which activity zone, which smoke study zone, because selection of the environmental position, we also use the smoke studies. So based on the smoke study, we understand that there is a turbulence here. I'm not talking about the filling lines. I'm talking about the grade B area where you have to do the selection. In grade A area also, you have to do the selection based on the risk and the high movement areas. Process simulation, I already mentioned that you have to ensure that your process simulation is in line with your the commercial batches. I already mentioned about the router for cross-contamination, facility design, equipment design, proper identification, proper line clearance, physical segregation, mechanical transfer. I already explained about incorporation process related design elements, wraps, isolators, personal and material flows, closed process or automated process to transfer the material. So I prefer closed process or automation process, which you have to think out of the box for the your conventional line. For the new line in your URS and design, please ensure that it is closed transfers. Dedicated equipment facility, that is a very easy to do that. Self-contained processing modules, disposable technologies, cleaning considerations. So these are the few of the newer ideas now industries have started taking into the consideration, which we have already done. We have disposable technologies. We have the self-contained processing modules. So please consider these for the avoiding the cross-contamination. And also see the airborne transfer like dedicated self-contained facilities, closed progressive system, HVAC design, pressure gradient. As I explained, you have the HVAC design, great. You have the dedicated AHUs for your grade A, grade B, grade C, grade D. However, you have to ensure that the gradient between these two zones. And then you have to see that generally people are going with the mechanized dampers. What they are doing when the door is open and air is going to be utilized, they increase the pressure by which the gradient is maintained. So these are the some of the design criteria which you have to take into consideration. For the grade A zone, my very, very strong suggestion to you is that you have to have at least OREPs. And wherever you have to OREPs, you have to design your glow pots in such a way that you do the engineering run of the or the water run, and you do the aseptic manipulation and intervention, and you design, okay, at this particular zone, I have to do the aseptic manipulation or intervention where you design your flow port. So what we have done recently, based on this approach and thinking and science, we used to have the 4 or 5 glows. Now we have 14 glow ports. So each port is designed scientifically based on our history and the practices about the and the operator interview. We have designed the glow port in such a way that now no more open door intervention. So what, how it has helped the smoke studies? When you do the open door intervention, all the smoke will run away. So that we have stopped. Another point is that you don't have to do what we call this is the open door. You have to lean into the grade A area. Operator will not go into the grade area. So operator has to be maintained B. So there are so many what we call this as a benefits if you don't do the open door interventions. So I'll just skip these slides about risk assessment. You are aware about the risk assessment. What might go wrong? What is the likelihood will go wrong? What are the consequences of severity of this? What could go wrong? The process by which existing hazards are identified, the estimation of the risk associated with the identified hazards, compare the identify analyze the risk against the given risk criteria, the process of decision making to reduce and or accept risk, implementation of control strategy to mitigate the risk. So this is a risk assessment which I have mentioned, not only the aseptic area, but everywhere you do the risk assessment. And one is holistic risk assessment and design accordingly. And then you will see that your success rates are very, very high. One of the case study. Like this is a skid for the injectable. So this is a inadequate or orbital welding joints, the transfer pipes in here. And there was a media fill failure. And because of this uneven surface, the biofilm was formed. So it has taken us almost 6 months to identify this. Then what we have done, we have taken the kappa and then put the skids, or whether it's a water line or purified water line or steam lines, wherever there is orbital, we don't go with the 10, we go with the 100% borescope, period. We don't go with the 10%. So please, I suggest you go with the 100% boroscopy and 25% x-rays, and you do the hydro test. So if you do so, you have the quiet sleep nights. Premises, I already mentioned about the quality by design, contamination control strategy, layouts, process flow. I already have discussed with you, so not going in that detail. Clean room consideration, everybody is aware, consider the following while selection of the monitoring locations. I already mentioned about the risk based on the risk assessment, process knowledge, operators to be performed in that area, critical processing zones, unidirectional airflow system. I mentioned homogeneous airspeed to range between 0.36 to 0.54. In other ranges, is followed have scientific justification. Airflow visualization, smoke study, I have already touched base on this. Area with pressure differential, I have already touched base about warning and alarms in case if it is going out. Smoke studies, I mentioned something about that, but I want to highlight something for the smoke study when we do. So when we do the video shooting, lighting, background impact, shooting angles and number of cameras, reflection of the shiny surface, shoot from the starting at the top of the working area. So these are the things, if you go in that direction and there is no obstacles, so then you have the good videography. In the online review, adequate smoke density, water versus glycol. Nowadays, glycol is a heavier particle, so it try to settle fast. So the speed is impacting that. So now FDA is expecting water-based smoke. Correct angle or smoke sticks, I already mentioned that the angle is very critical. Equipment setup is critical. Smoke stick motion within the unit system. So one is a fixed cameras, and then the moving cameras. Then simultaneously, you have to be very smart enough when you do the smoke study, your smoke position in such a way, because people used to do, they fix the smoke generator stick here, and then smoke start coming, and initially it is dense and it's become lighter. So you have to take it down little and see that the smoke is coming at the end also is the required smoke. Video clip, you have to do the video clip review for the airflow pattern, aseptic behavior and the practices. Because what happened when the regulators, they are seeing the smoke study, they are also seeing the aseptic behavior of the people. Because smoke study is not done only for the static condition. Smoke study is done for the transportation from autoclave to the like material movement to the your filling station, your main movement from the your governing to the filling station, your assembly, your disassembly, your running, your intervention, everything has to be built into the smoke studies. As I mentioned, air visualization is a part of the contamination control strategy. The smoke study is used to erode the risk of contamination and inform the effect of the actual air flow pattern by performing simulation while introducing trace particle during a normal operation, personal interaction and movement, surrounding environment. The violation of the actual airflow pattern is used to identify risk associated with the clean rooms barrier system design and integration, identify risk associated with the normal operation and intervention and equipment assembly and environmental monitoring, establish risk-based monitoring location of viable and non-viable. So these are the where the smoke studies are useful. Initial smoke studies should be conducted as part of engineering and manufacturing studies to optimize equipment operator movement. I already mentioned that you have to do engineering media fill, you have to do engineering smoke study also to establish everything. And once you are confident enough, then you start taking the shoots of the smokes. Type of smoke study like investigative airflow visualized studies, diagnosing contamination problem, early confirmation of design criteria. Engineering airflow visualization studies like gaining an understanding of air pattern, personal movement for the purpose of optimization and risk analysis prior to qualification. Static airflow visualization studies, like studies conducted without personal movement. Dynamic airflow visualization studies, like studies conducted with personnel and equipment conducting simulation or operation. In situ static dynamic air pattern analysis, the big deal smoke studies for documentary purpose for final qualification and meeting regulatory expectation. What companies do after a bad smoke study, airflow visualization, to modify the clean room barrier system or personal behavior to address the problem and repeat the testing? So engineering smoke study will give you insight where I have to improve, whether I have to improve the design, where I have to improve the assembly procedure, whether I have to improve my people behavior. All these will you come to know during your engineering smoke study or the field smoke study. Increase the aim of the location operation include in this risk analysis. Argued about subject nature of the study and continue operation. Ignore the result, find another testing agency and hope that they don't find the problem. So many times what happened, because smoke study is an art by itself to do the shooting. I cannot do the shooting of the smoke study or somebody else. So you have to have the trained video shooters to do the smoke studies. So that is why the engineering smoke study is very critical. You are not able to take the judgment based on then you have to change your this service providers. So air visualization grade A space, identify worst location in air monitoring, look for turbulence in grade A, look for entrapment B to A, must do in address state, in the dynamic state around the interventions, must do whenever major changes, should repeat periodically, use video as a training tools for the aseptic operator, which I already mentioned earlier. Now coming to the media fill, I don't know Uday, how much time I have.
Don't worry about your time, you can go on, we can extend that.
Yeah, so in the media fill and design, media fill imitate as closely as possible, as closely as possible to the routine aseptic manufacturing process, cover all critical manufacturing steps. Worst case condition covering line speed, container size, batch size, hold time, etc. In the runs, initial validation with at least three consecutive satisfactory simulation tests and revalidation after 6 months that cover all working shifts. So you have to be very smart enough in selecting the runs. Like you have the disposable bag assembly, you have the peristaltic pump assembly, you have the piston pump assembly, you have the conventional 316L filling assemblies. So there are, you have so many variability in your systems. Then how you will design your media? So you have to design whether you want to do matrixing of that. I don't think you can do matrixing for the peristaltic pump assembly versus the piston pump assembly. I don't think you can do the simulation of the one-time use disposable bag assembly versus the autoclave stainless steel filling assembly. So you have to be very careful about designing the media filters. Generally, people do the matrixing about the small size and big size, and then small mouth and big mouth, but they have never taken in consideration about what I have mentioned. Interventions, all routine and non-routine intervention cover at maximum acceptable frequency per number of fill units. Duration of the intervention should be the same as routine production. Poor process intervention should not be designed or selected to justify poor process or facility design. So this is very critical. Your poor processes should not be simulated into the media fill, and media fill is passed, you justify your poor processes. It's not acceptable. Environmental monitoring is conducted similar as routine production. Reconciliation, 100% reconciliation of units process. And acceptance criteria, the target should be zero growth. Any contaminated unit should result in a failed process simulations. So what are the different type of media fills? The startup media fills, which is initial validation, at least three consecutive successful process simulations are performed when qualifying a new facility. filling line or process before starting the routine manufacturing. Periodic media fill, that is periodic requalification, each aseptic product processing line required to have periodic media fill frequency every 6 months. So here, once you do the three consecutive successful process evaluation about different configuration and with the matrixing approach about your container closure, you do all this, and then in periodic media fill, which you do every 6 monthly, then you start repeating your configuration and the container closure. Closing media fill needs to be performed after the last commercial batch prior to the major shutdown without any change in the line process. So this is very critical, because if you want to take the shutdown, it's like a sandwiching of your calibration. You want to retire your equipment, you have to qualify the equipment first to ensure that whatever the from the previous qualification to this qualification, my whatever the product is manufactured are within the qualified state or calibrated state. So same way, if you want to do shutdown of your line or some major breakdown or major updation, you have to do the closing media fill as well. The critical attributes: operator intervention, manipulation, fill volume, container size, container closure system, line speed, run duration, batch size, number of personnel, hold time, facility design, handling of intervention, environmental condition, incubation, inspection, and acceptance criteria. These are the critical attributes for the media fill. The media selection, as I mentioned earlier also, your some of the atypical colony isolates or some of the isolates and media fill, you have to ensure that your media is capable to grow that organism for which you have to do the recovery studies. Duration of media should be sufficient to adequately challenge to aseptic process. The operator that perform interventions, filling duration should be not less than the routine filling duration of the production batch. Actual filling shall be performed to cover initial, middle, and end of the filling duration of all the shifts. Please ensure this is a very critical. Batch size consideration, small scale less than 5,000 unit should be at least equal to production batch size. Middle scale 5,000 to 10,000 units should be at least equal or more than batch size. Larger scale more than 10,000, then media fill batch size must not less than 10,000 units. Operating shifts, I have mentioned, if the operation perform in all three shifts, then media fill study should consider and capture all three shifts and shift changeover in the simulations. The media fill should be designed to capture specific factor like those manufacturing during a night or extended shift, fatigue should be considered. So this is critical. Like many times what happened that our commercial batch is extended and then it has run for 12 hours. So similarly, those extended media fill has to be done. So fatigue of the operator will also taken consideration, because once the fatigue starts, operator behavior start changing. And once the operator behavior start changing, as I mentioned about the behavior skill sets, everything is under question. And then you have the issues about the, all the interventions or the operation, what they are performing. And their behavior also into the aseptic area is changed. So fatigue is a critical point which is considered due to the media fill. Utilities compressor shall be used for media fill instead of nitrogen gas. Filter consideration, aseptic filtration of the media fill shall be performed using 0.22 micron filters, sterile grade. Hold time consideration, the hold times of sterile equipment, sterile closure and build media shall be covered under worst case matrix. Container closure configuration, bracketing or matrixing approach may be considered, right? That is what my point was. For process simulation of the same container closure configuration of different product, where process equivalence is sufficient, scientifically justified. Periodically, one successful run to be taken for each size of vial within the matrix and at least three successful run of newly introduced vials. Container size, the smallest and the biggest size of the container shall be challenged to demonstrate bracketing of the container size. Large container with the widest mouth with slow speed. Sorry, there is a spelling check. And small container with the widest mouth with the high speed. Filling speed. The filling machine speed for all products needs to be listed in the media fill matrix and need to be simulated during media fill recommends to use single speed, either highest or lowest alternative for the simulation, the different media filters. Lowest line speed, large container with the widest mouth, high speed, small container with the widest mouth. Fill volume, there must be enough medium in the container to contact all container closure seal surfaces when the container is inverted in this world. Leak test, if the leak testing is a part of the aseptic process of the product batch, then leak test shall be performed for the media fill. Visual inspection prior to incubation, visual inspection of the media fill container to be performed by use of visual inspection booth against the black and white background. Here, I want to touch base, even though I have not mentioned here, the visual inspector for the media fill is different than the visual inspector for your routine commercial products. In this particular visual inspection qualification, you use the qualified visual inspector, but especially in this particular case, in the kit, you have to give them the very, very less contaminated media. So whether how it is possible, so because why I'm saying that, okay, if there is a slow growing organism which is grow very slow in the 14 day, then the growth and the density of the growth and the concentration of growth is such a less, then visual inspector may pass it and there will be false negative. So for this, there are some chemicals which is available that you prepare that, so the concentration of that will be similar to the concentration of the bacteria by which you have to prepare that kit, and then you qualify the operator to see the lowest concentration or the turbidity into the media. Growth promotion test, I already touched base. Acceptance criteria, I already mentioned. Intervention of media fill. So these are the intervention, routine intervention and non-routine intervention. So these are some of the examples. Aseptic assembly of equipment before use, adjustment of the machine track, initial product connections, fill, weight checks, bubble point testing filters, component addition, vial stoppers, caps, environmental monitoring, any other intervention that is part of the normal process, stoppage due to shift change, meal or rest break, a non-routine intervention, in-process adjustment of the machine rack, removing of defective seals, removing of vials from the line that have jammed, removing vials from the line that have fallen over, product filler change, replacement of filling needles, product spillage or leakage, poorly fitting stoppers, any other problem. So I mentioned earlier during my startup that non-routine interventions, please design based on your historical runs, number of additions, number of interventions, now how many times you do the fallen vials. So in your 6 month trend, you see that you have done in a 100,000 vial batch, you have done for 15 times. So these 15 times plus one, you have to do the simulation in non-routine intervention in your media. You have to add the rubber stopper, 5,000 rubber stopper, let's say for the 100,000 bag, almost 20 times. Then you have to do similarly plus one or plus two. Likewise, so based on a historical trend about your interventions, you design your intervention more than what you are doing in commercial ones. Microbial environmental monitoring, I mentioned, but I will just quickly go through viable monitoring, sample site selection. I mentioned about that, this is based on the risk-based rationalize and consider the smoke study where applicable. Trending, I already mentioned, set alert and action level, apply microbials speciation wherever it is required. So microbial speciation where it is required, I will go to the next slide and I will explain. Settled plate exposure time based on the recovery studies, and then not allowed media to discussion or dry. Exclusively monitor testing does not give sterility assurance, so do not consider EM program as substitute for the robust sterility assurance systems. define isolate identification strategy. I will go to the next slide. Type of monitoring like active air sampling, setup plate, contact plates, swab sampling, these are the some of the environmental monitoring program. So the sampling location for both selected using a documented risk-based approach that is reviewed and repeated periodically to account for any change in the process or the clean rooms. So based on the risk-based approach, you finalize your environmental monitoring program. But periodically, this is a very critical point for everybody to understand. Periodically, you have to review your risk-based approach and see that your position, your location or environment program still continue or still stand goods, or you have to redefine it. EM program should be defined, documented, and maintained with the return procedures. The routine grade A and B monitoring, non-viable particle count, grade A must be continue monitoring, grade B continuous, not mandatory, one preferred, but I prefer grade B in the continuous monitoring. There is an association between NVP and microbes that I already mentioned why we want to do non-viable, because of it, there is association with the microbes. Viable particles, like variety of techniques, all have reason for the challenge, like settle plates, contact plates, active assembly surfaces. I already touched bases on the earlier. Must monitor operator glows post intervention and on exit of room and glow periodically. So generally what we are doing now, that 99.9% we don't do the open door intervention. But even though if there is open door intervention, immediately we go for the glow monitoring programs and the finger dip programs. In case of any intervention also, if the operator is done or any assembly which is done, after that we do the finger dip program and glow monitoring programs. I already mentioned viable monitoring, the location, frequency and duration of EM plate monitoring, alert and action level programs where we use the statistical tools, and then personal monitoring program. All these I have already mentioned, so I go to the next slide. This is a critical viable monitoring identification of EM isolates. So what is the minimum expectation? Extent of identification characterization. Minimum expectation is the characterization of gram stain reaction and morphology. Their environmental monitoring of grade C and D, classification area of alert and alert level excursion, where we do the gram staining. Identification of genus level and species level when possible using phenotypic method. Environmental monitoring of action level excursion of grade C and D. As I mentioned earlier, if you remember, I mentioned that wherever there is a repetitive observation and excursion, or there is an action level excursion in grade C and D also, you have to do the identification of genus level. Identification of species level using phenotypic method, grade A and B are classification area and alert and or action level isolate from excipient, finished product, environment and water samples. Strain typing or molecular fingerprinting genotyping method, significant product contamination failure like media fill or salinity test, and significant adverse strains in environment and water monitoring, then you do the screening. So microbial identification should be performed where atypical or potentially objectionable microorganisms are recovered. So that is irrespective of anywhere you have to go with the identification test. And quarterly and annually strain analysis should be performed to assess the capability of the contamination control measures. Non-viable, minimum number of sampling location defined as for ISO. Non-viable particle count monitoring location selected based on the grid profile. I already explained to you, so I don't go in more detail about that. And rationale should be prepared for each location. Continuous monitoring of grade and B area during batch manufacturing monitoring shall be started from the filling assembly onwards. So many people are done once the filling starts, then they start the monitoring. It is not like that. You have to start from the assembly bottom. Non-viable particle counts monitoring tubing length should be no greater than 1 meter with a minimum number of bends, and bend radius should be greater than 15 centimeter. Non-viable particle count monitoring deposition tunnel should be performed beginning and end of the each lot manufacturing. I already mentioned in my previous discussion. error level should be based on historical data, but should be lower than action level. Statistical tool used for establishment of alert level. Trend analysis shall be performed. So trends, trend analysis for viable and non-viable is very critical to see that what is the cross-contamination level. I just skip this. These are the SIP, how to do the SIP qualification. Then terminus liaison, these are the common points. So as I mentioned earlier, the cleaning and disinfection for the aseptic manufacturing and controlling the microorganisms and cross-contamination. So qualification of supplier is the first point. You have to qualify your supplier for the cleaning and sanitation agents. Then disinfectant agent efficacy on different surface with a different vegetative and spore-forming organisms. I already explained, but I have not explained the different surface. So you have to see that what are the different surfaces are there, like stainless steel, rubber, neoprene, plastics, Teflon. So identify which are the parts which are coming in, which are there in the filling machine or your end product context, and do the disinfection efficacy study on that. Sterilization and storage of the antimicrobial chemical agent used in aseptic area. You have to sterilize and store and give the use before date based on your validation program. In use expiration dating of the disinfection agent, hold time of clean areas and utensils. I mentioned to them. Sterilization and storage of cleaning equipment like sprayer, buckets, smoke fans, and mops. So even we are focusing more into cleaning and disinfecting agent. Are we focusing onto the aids like sprayers, buckets, mop heads, and mops? No, we are not. So my strong suggestion that also has to be focused and sterilized. Frequency of cleaning and disinfection that we need to define based on validation. And I again and again mentioned that use the one time sporicidal agent once in a week. Rotation of agent and contact time. So now this is very critical. I want to take some time in the contact time. So what happened that many of the validation don't mention, they mention okay, contact time is 3 minutes and we achieve the 2 logs. Contact time is 15 minutes for the sporicidal and we have achieved the 2 logs. Is this contact times are part of your SOP? Is this contact time SOP is part of your routine monitoring? Whether it is recorded somewhere? If no, please do that. Another point is that the FDA is looking that this contact time, whether it is 3 minutes or 15 minutes, whether your surface remain wet or the surface remain dry. So FDA or regulatory expectation that during this time, surface has to remain wet. That is how you are doing your validation and validation of disinfection agents. This cleaning and disinfection after shutdown or an excursions and documentation of cleaning and disinfection that I already mentioned. Training qualification and the responsibility of the personnel and supervisor, that is a part of that. So so this is very critical to do control the microbial contamination, cleaning and disinfection selection, vendor approval, validation, routine practice, sterilization, cleaning aids, and then ensure that whatever the validation is done, it is part of your routine practice. Filter validation, these are the criteria. Bacterial retention in water, saline lactose broth with integrity test correlation in water or solvent, bacterial retention in product, chemical compatibility, extractable, leachable, sterilization method, effect of filter integrity, integrity test water or solvent, integrity test method, selection, based on the product, toxicity testing as per USP class 6, bacterial endotoxin, particulate matter. So these are the criteria by which filter is validated. In this validation, critical process parameters are flow rate, inlet and differential pressure, filtration process temperature, filtration time, and filter throughputs. Visual inspection, I already touched base. Defect classification of criticality, determined during the qualification based on the risk and historical knowledge, and consider route of administration. Defect library, I already mentioned, capture all known defects of the classes, use of training of production and QA personnel. Critical defects should not be identified during any subsequent sampling and inspection of acceptable container. If identified, trigger investigation. Manual inspection versus automated inspections, that both are required qualification. So in manual inspection, I have mentioned inspection rates should be controlled. Automated inspection machine validated to detect known defects and should be more than the manual inspection method, and challenge performed prior to startup. So each unit may be examined manually with the unaided eyes of semi-automated inspection for light obstruction, yellow obstruction, or automated inspection. Critical process parameter in manual visual inspection, light intensity, background and contrast, inspection rates. So I already mentioned in earlier slide, critical process parameter, semi-automated visual inspection, light intensity, rate of inspection, spin speed, etc. Qualification and validation of manual inspection, visual inspection is selection and training of visual inspector. Should be tested for vision actually and color perception. Qualification of visual inspector. Distance criteria, holding of container against the white and black background, total time of visual inspection, and light lux level requirements. In the CCIT, container closure integrity, this is a life cycle approach, packaging development, component assembly, attribute to the weld, seal, vial, identification of potential defects, manufacturing process like equipment selection, sealing optimization, manufacturing defects, deviations in case. And self-life assessment like time to expiry, storage condition, transportation challenge, 100% inspection techniques, HVLD, and vacuum pressure decay and HSA. So aspect of container closure integrity, permeation, migration like leakage through defects, crack, holes, split, tear, incomplete component, through seal like seal integrity, insufficient compression, failure to maintain compression. Way forward, the CCI failure can be mitigated by ensuring appropriate coil stopper combination in capping and crimping parameter. So this is very critical. Like coils are having their own tolerance for the neck and diameter and everything. Stoppers are having its own tolerance with the collar height and thickness of the stoppers and neck. So this tolerance should be matched in such a way that the combination of the vial stopper and after capping, the it is hermetically sealed and there are no permeation or migration. That is another big point, RSF, that is a residual seal force. So generally, residual seal force nowadays, nobody is maintaining that. But the residual seal force is very critical for the powder injection or lifeless injection. If your residual seal force is more, you have the possibility of the penetration or migration of this. So how we can achieve the residual seal force? By proper capping machine and by quality by a design for selection of the equipment, by selection of vial and stoppers. Laser headspace analysis is a suitable non-destructive method to detect temporary leaks in the cold storage. The container closure integrity testing, the life cycle approach, release of packaging material, supplier monitoring of primary packing material, stopper height, crimping sealing validation, media fills, microbial packaging simulation, visual inspection, sterility testing, and shipping and transportation. So these are the some of the challenge studies which we are doing, like 100% integrity testing. Then other than ampoule or bag should undergo a product known as a risk-based CCIT evaluation. CCIT within the self-life stability test is recommended. Then bacterial ingress test has to be done with the sandwich the copper wire inside. Integrity test method like dye ingress testing, vacuum decay test, or high voltage leak test is also recommended for this. These are some of the examples. And some of the technology like we have the revs, I already mentioned about the revs, which are the revs generally have to be cleaned and decontented manually. These are the advantages. Much lower capital expenditure. Everyday multi-product manufacturing, easier to adapt for conventional clean rooms. Retrofit, less qualification. But disadvantage is a lower SL, because in the revs, many times, as I mentioned, if you not properly ergonomically design your low port, then you have to open the door. When you open the door, as I mentioned, there are many disadvantages when you are opening the door. I already mentioned. Isolator is completely sealed system. So isolator is itself known as isolates. So isolates from you to the product. That is, one is the microbial contamination controls. Second is the product controls. There are PET inspection tools which is available. These are the PET inspection tool, 100% glass inspection integrated with the vial filling machines. So these are now available. The PET inspection tool for 100% stopper inspection integrated with the vial filling line, that stopper is properly placed and there is no stopper, nothing as are done in the PET inspection for the stoppers. Limiting personal interactions, I already mentioned, like conventional clean room, open wraps, then open active wraps, close wraps, low fill seal machine, isolators, automatic loading and loading system. I mentioned about the lyophilizer. Nowadays, the manual loading system is not recommended or encouraged. We need to go with the automatic loading and unloading system. If we don't have, we have the conventional lines, we have the old lines, then in that case, we have to ensure that A to A transfers are done properly with the proper smoke study and media fit. So what are the benefits if with limiting personal interaction, reduce human intervention, reduce risk factor for sterility challenge, reduce foreign particle in the product, economics in container closure processing, increased quality assurance level, high level of support and productivity. So here, operator dependency is avoided. Once the operator dependency is avoided, then there is isolation and personal interaction is close, and these are the so many benefits in that. These are the, some of the computer controls, system controls, which nowadays we are, now many new machines are coming with the SCADA systems. If you are coming with the SCADA system, great. Use the SCADAs, but focus on the lack of basic access control and security measure. Share user login, so don't do this. These are the regulatory focus for the SCADAs. Overwriting or deletion of original data, orphan omitted data for review data availability, and missing of disabled audit trails or inadequate software validation. So nowadays for India, we are extremely good into the now laboratory. We have the 100% partition compliance equipment, chromatography, non-chromatography systems. Now SCADA also is coming, or PLC or HMI is coming, which is part 11. So once we have the SCADA, please ensure all these, we are not like that, because regulatory is focusing this activity. So ERES means like electronic signature and electronic record requirement for part 11 of NXRF 1 and 2. System validation for completeness and accuracy of electronic data. Storage, retrieval and copying of the electronic record in full retention period. Audit trail, who did what, when include design. Protection of electronic record security, physical and logical privilege based access, and electronic signature, name, date, sign. So these are the things which we already have in QC good way. Now SCADA and HMI or the data historian, we should have this. Future of pharmaceutical quality, Six Sigma, adopt emerging technology, as I mentioned earlier. Move away the operators and see that operator dependency and interventions are avoided. Moving clinically relevant specification, risk assessment, DOE, PET tools, prior knowledge, quality by design. This is a circle. What are the derailers? The absence of the long-term strategy, poor execution, the lack of discipline, fail to take off to maintain momentum and then end up crashing. Lack of capability building, reskilling of entire workforce and leadership. Silos functioning like engagement at all the levels. speed, innovation, velocity, empathy towards the projected timelines and bad multitasking, agile quality culture, like set up a culture that supports the constant change. Always remember the culture eats a strategy into the breakfast. Thank you very much. Sorry to taking more time. Thank you very much for this. Uday. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible, yes.
Thank you, Uday. Thank you, everybody, for the patience really listening to me.
Hey, now there are several questions. I think we'll take few of them, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I have some another meeting, but anyway, I will take something here.
Yeah, a few questions we'll take. Let's see. So, as per a recent 483 observation to one of the company, is finger dab monitoring after keeping settle plate in LAF or grade A? So this company had got this observation.
So what is the question?
The question is finger dab monitoring required after keeping settle plate in LAF or in grade A?
No, it is not.
Okay.
So if you use the glow pot, then it is not required. But if you do the open door intervention, then you require.
So here's the next question. What is the allowed density of smoke that is to be used for smoke studies?
So it's a very good question. There are no specific answer to that. Density measurement is very difficult, but as I mentioned, that it should be the visible smoke. That many times what happens that the highly dense smoke will also create the turbulence because of its own movement, Brownian movement of that. So you have to be ensured that you have the enough smoke, so not dense, not light, and then it is enough. And as I mentioned, that PG versus water, the heavier smoke will settle fast, the movement will be fast, then it also can create the turbulence, so it will be false positive unnecessarily.
Thank you. How to handle the tools during breakdown condition of aseptic filling machine? Is it possible to sterilize all the tools if they are to be used for breakdown?
I don't think all the tools can be sterilized. So in such cases, once the breakdown is there and the tools are not sterilized, and then once the breakdown is completed, you have to ensure the monitor, as I mentioned about the sanitizer, cleaning and sanitization, spraying and decontamination of the area, monitoring for 3 days based on the risk, and then you start the machine again.
Thank you. What is your view on pre-use post-sterilization integrity testing?
I'm sorry, say it again.
What is your view on pre-use post-sterility integrity testing? Is it a must? PubSit.
No, it is not.
Thank you.
So what my understanding is, do you require to do the pre-integrity and post-integrity? That is a
yes.
Question.
Yes.
My recommendation is not, because unnecessary we are exposing the filter to the your solvent and something. So it is always to do the post-integrity. So there is a risk, but post-integrity is a real indicator.
Okay, let's take something interesting. Does compounding area grade C require LAF on compounding vessel? Whether any guidelines is there on this requirement?
Very good question. There is no guidance as such required. But based on your assessment, if you don't use the LF on top of the compounding, 99% generally your compounding vessel, as I mentioned, quality by design. Your HEPA filters are designed in such a way that you have the flow on directly into the open compounding vessel. If you, I try to avoid the open compounding vessel, it is always closed so that the exposure to the environment is minimized. But if you have the open mouth vessel and do the compounding in that, then ensure that your HEPA filter is directly coming there. LF is not required. But after the compounding, if you have the high bioburden, because bioburden limit should be there for the unfiltered work, because filtration is always due on the log reduction, that is 3 log reduction. So if you have the TNTC in unfiltered work, then there is something wrong into your system and environment. Then my suggestion is to put in that.
Thank you. What is the regulatory outlook on use of alternate microbial methods like real-time viable particle monitors for environmental monitoring?
Not understood the question. Real-time microbial?
This is, you know, alternate microbial methods like real-time viable particle monitors for environmental monitoring.
Now that is recommended. Now people are coming up with those and then we are also going for that. Only thing, the validation is very difficult to do that, but nowadays this real-time microbial monitoring of genotyping and based on DNA, it is possible and it is recommended also. So it will give you the age of the time and then you immediately get to know.
This is a question on growth promotion testing. In GPT, we are doing study with healthy organisms, but in actual case, those organisms which are in aseptic area actually ruptured unhealthy. Do we really need to make such organisms and challenge it in GPT?
As I mentioned, answer to that is very similar. Like microbial sterility failure isolates, you have to ensure that there is a recovery studies into growth, and then environmental isolates which are there, you have to do the recovery studies into the growth. So recovery studies is indirectly giving you the growth promotion. So environmental isolates is are the compromised organisms always.
Okay, this is about initial area qualification. In initial area qualification, can we take same or more location for viables as we are taking for NVPC as per ISO 14644? What is minimum grid can be considered while area qualification? I don't know if I've understood this question.
So that is a good question. Grid preparation is based on the area dimensions, and then more number of plate exposure to identify the worst location is also recommended. But to avoid those things, then as I mentioned in my presentation, the risk approach about the man and material movement and air movement and the smoke studies, you define the area for the this positioning of your viable this one based on the grids.
What is the best practice in terms of environmental monitoring testing, for example when to perform swab or when to perform contact plates?
The best practice is always the contact plates. But wherever the contact plates are not possible, like needles or pumps or something, after the completion of filling machine, the swab is better.
Okay, I think there are almost 50 to 100 questions. I don't think we'll be able to take all. So I'll just take one last question. Let me see something interesting. Okay, this is about batch size for media fill. Whether batch size of media fill should be as large as the big batch size, that is the actual production batch size.
As I mentioned in my media fill presentation, it can be more than 10,000. So it can represent your entire batch size. If you do the full batch size, that is a great. If you cannot, then you have to do more than 10,000, but you have to ensure that the entire process of your 100,000 batch size, suppose if you have 100,000, is simulated during that time, including fatigue of the operator.
Thank you. So thank you, Mr. Doshi, for your presentation. Excellent. It really reflected your experience of so many years and all that you have faced, facing so many regulatory agencies, EMA, FDA, WHO, and others. If you have got several compliments for your presentation, that excellent presentation, and we'll be sending this, we'll be uploading the recorded webinar on our YouTube channel, so more people will be able to listen to your talk. We had more than 500 people who logged in today, so thank you so much for your presentation and answering all these questions. And before we conclude, if you'd like to say final concluding remarks to all the delegates.
No, thank you. I have tried to cover as far as possible because it's a big subject, big learnings. So I hope that in next seminar, if we organize such things, I can share my more views about the sterility assurance. So thank you very much for the joining, and thank you for the great questions. And then I hope that you will gain something from this and implement at your level, and then avoid some of those citations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, delegates, for joining, taking time out and being here today. Please do join us in the new year, January 6 at 4 p.m. for a webinar on the 5-step checklist for a more mature, robust quality management system. Stay safe, follow all COVID protocols, and best wishes for a wonderful year ahead. With this, we are closing this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you.